And from the top of West Mountain, Scranton, Pennsylvania, good morning, everybody. This is 94.3 FM, the talk of Sanity Check, Libertarian Lou. We got Tea Party Mike. X will be joining us, as always. Frank Sorek is in studio. We have a full slate ahead of us, so all kinds of interviews coming on today. So if you want to start your weekend off right, blow off a little steam, this is the time to do it, this first part of the show. The number is 888-577-4487. That's 888-577-4487. Good morning, Michael.
Good morning, Lou. We're just here in Texas, and I just want to let you know that we've started the discussion here in Texas on the marijuana laws, so yes. We're not to be outdone with the rest of the West. But currently not trying to legalize it, but to minimize the penalty.
Yeah.
Currently, it's, and it's the discussion of really the nonviolent crimes and the amount of people that are in jail for that. Currently, if you're caught with an ounce or less, it's $2,000 fine plus 6 months in jail.
Oh, boy.
And they're just, and they're trying to reduce it to $250 and no time in jail. So that's what's going on in Austin, the capital of Texas. And again, it seems like it's going to be a discussion throughout the nation.
There you go. I was going to talk a little bit about what's happened in the Wild West and what's happening in parts around the country here. But of course, when we talk about the Wild West, Michael, we're not always talking about Austin, Texas, or Montana, or Idaho, or Colorado. We could be talking about Wilkes-Barre, Frank.
My hometown.
and Lacey's hometown.
Well, let me just say this. Wilkes-Barre is a lot like the Wild West, just not as safe as the Wild West was.
It is. I haven't been, I'm not completely caught up with what's happened in this past week, but I didn't know if there was any, Michael, there's new shootings every day. It's something's always happening over there. It's really pretty
shot,
crazy.
You're going to be stabbed. That's it.
It's unbelievable. So let's bring X on too already this morning because we'll find out what's on his mind. Good morning, X.
Hey, guys. How you doing?
We're doing okay. How you doing?
I'm not too good.
We got your, what's that?
No, I'm just looking forward to the whole Texas thing with their marijuana debates also. It's spreading across the country, this idea of, why are we imposing such harsh penalties for something while bankers, can rig LIBOR, drug companies can poison kids and stuff like that, and nobody goes to jail over there.
I had an interesting discussion about what we talked about last week a little bit with the LIBOR stuff, and certainly we just got your new article, and maybe it'll be published in Breitbart before we actually get to go to print about it. And it talks about the LIBOR and all those things. But had an interesting conversation this week also is about there's another five new banks that just got fined, I guess, trillions of dollars. I know, X, you brought up last week about Deutsche Bank, $2.5 trillion they were fined. And once again, nobody went to jail. And here's another five banks that are going to be fined trillions of dollars. But the question that was raised was, who gets these fines? Is it the people that got screwed or is it the government? And then, of course, if these banks give the money to the government, is a little ironic, then we turn around and the government gives it right back to the banks. Nobody goes
to
jail. Too big to fail. So what's going on? I'll let you guys chime in about that a little bit here. Anybody have any idea or any thoughts on who gets these fines? And do the fines just come back to the government and then the government just turns about? It's kind of like, Michael, you get fined in the courts.
It all comes out in the wash.
And then it comes right back to you, and say, okay, well, we're going to give you some kind of refund or something. It's just really kind of
stimulus.
Ironic. Stimulus, or whatever we call it. But it's really amazing that, this whole cycle of stuff, and we wonder why people are cynical about our courts. And we're going to be talking about our whole court system here, a good portion of our show today, because we have some interesting guests coming on there. But who wants to chime in on that, about who gets the fines, and does it just go back into the banks? X, I'll throw that one to you.
It's a revolving cycle, Basically, the fines essentially are just like speed bumps, in a parking garage or something like that. It doesn't stop you from leaving the garage. It's just a minor inconvenience on your way to where you're eventually going. And unfortunately, for the most of the participants within this. The scary part is it's just the misallocation of justice, where, again, the small individual is always, you know, hammered with the full extent of the law.
It's amazing.
And at the same time, once you get above a certain size in corporate America, you almost have like a get-out-of-jail-free card where, you know, whatever it is, it's just a question of how big of a check you'll be writing. And it's never from the person who, you know, I mean, somebody had to make a decision to rig LIBOR. Somebody had to make a decision to illegally, you know, transfer known drug cartel money. Somebody had to know at the drug companies that, hey, this drug is harmful. This drug doesn't work. This drug is a fraud. But that doesn't matter. That doesn't matter in society.
It doesn't matter at all. Michael, any thoughts on
this? It's Hillary's fault. It's Hillary's fault.
Poor Hillary.
Yeah, we'll stay off of Hillary this week.
Do you have any proof, or was it deleted?
If you have any proof, yeah, let's stay off Hillary this week. We can pick on the courts. We'll be able to pick on the courts and what's going on in the courts. And I swear, every single day I get some email or something comes across. Not only people asking for help, but it's a constant stuff. And at the end of the day, we've talked about this week after week about what's happening in the courts. And Michael, I got to tell you, man, if we don't have any justice in the courts, we have no justice here in America. And I think a lot of times we spend our time looking at, different causes. But so much of what has happened in the United States, as far as I'm concerned, has to do with the courts. And in a certain way also is educating the public about what's going on. Listen to the David Madeira show this week, as always, and we certainly recommend folks to tune into that. It certainly has a bigger reach and has more airtime than we do. He's 6 to 9 o'clock Monday through Friday. But David was talking about unwinding and reteaching. And just this past week, Michael and X and Frank, you know that, you know, I live right on Tunkhanna Creek, and people are fishing, Michael. And I saw it was later in the evening this past week, and saw an older gentleman out there, you know, doing his fly fishing right on my property there. So I walked down and said hello and see how he's doing. He was 70 years old, and he said everything's upside down. He said there's no fish. there's no fish. I don't get that either. I've never seen anything like this. I don't know. Maybe some fishermen will call in, but certainly on Tunkhanna Creek, it didn't seem like I haven't seen one fish taken out of the river this year. And it's really, really, Frank, I mean, it's amazing. But anyway, here's a 70-year-old guy. He's out there fishing, and I go up and say hello to him, and he says, everything's upside down. He says, the whole world's upside down. He says, so upside down, there's no fish anymore. He says, I don't get it. So
someone looted the creek?
But I asked him, somebody looted the creek. There you go. You know Sorek is from Wilkes-Barre. That's the first thing that pops into his mind, guys, is who looted what? Even the creek has been looted.
It's gone. Was Layton down there?
It's Layton down there. Poor Tom Layton, the king. We're picking on the king again.
He filled up his gas tank and went fishing.
He went fishing with nets. He netted them all.
That's right.
Oh, boy, oh, boy. But, Michael, so I had my pullover on, and it was one of those don't tread on me shirt. So the guy's looking at me, and then all of a sudden what happens is he said that we got to talking about, you know, everything. Mm-hmm. And I got into the debt thing, Michael. You know, he was a Tea Party guy, and we got into the debt. And once again, just talking about what's
the
going
NSA
on. I think, did we lose everybody? I don't know what happened there, Frank. But anyway, we could blame it on the NSA. It's always a good thing to do. It's always a good thing. Do we got you guys, Michael, or X? We still got you?
Yeah,
oh, good. So anyway, what happened, X, is that we got to talking about the Federal Reserve and all these other things, and at the end of the day, had no idea of how the debt's created and all those things, and it is all about not only unwinding and reteaching, but that's one of the things that we need to do, and it's really pretty crazy, Frank.
Are we still worried about the debt? I mean, seriously.
You don't hear about it anymore.
At
X, do we
point,
ever hear
I
about
don't
these
even,
things?
I'm not even sure what the debt is anymore, or how it's
created.
Yeah, or how we'll ever pay it back. I don't think we're worried about such things. We just have those printers running, and that's all that matters.
Yeah, and X, that was one of the things that did happen, actually, was when we talked about talking about how the debt is created and the whole thing. We got into the whole petrodollar, and you could see his eyes kind of light up, and certainly that's one of the things that we're looking to do here at the Independent Gazette. Frank, I think we lost.
We lost everybody. The NSA is really, if you're still hearing us, thank God. they're probably out there ripping down the tower right now. Those guys are done.
They're done.
Now they're on debt. Forget it.
But, you know, like when you were just saying, what's happened to our debt? We don't hear about it really on the news. I haven't heard it on the news.
It's just like a little ticker that keeps running at this point. Like, I don't think anyone's worried about it. Certainly Congress isn't. The president isn't. They just keep raising the debt ceiling and figure, oh, well, we don't worry about such things. Foreclosure might happen one day.
Yeah, absolutely. I think we got everybody back. It looks like things are a little bit solid here. Okay, Michael. So we were just talking about the debt and obviously some of the things that and we had a great conversation. We were down in Berks County yesterday, and it was kind of a meet and greet with the new Berks County Independent Gazette. And on our next segment, we're going to have Charmaine Bradley from the Carbon County Independent Gazette and some of the stuff that they're doing down there. But certainly, you know, it was all about how it's all about educating and talking about some of these issues that we feel as though that the general public have no idea about what's going on. It's really amazing. Michael?
Well, what amazes me is that the general public doesn't seem to care. It's almost, out of sight, out of mind, and I don't have to really notice about this thing because I think so many of us have bought into, don't worry, the government will be on the rescue no matter what occurs.
I don't think that's it at all. I think the average Joe just has his nose to the grindstone, and he is just treading water, and he figures if he looks up to pay attention for a split second, he's going to lose everything.
Well, I think that's quite that's very reasonable assumption there, Frank.
They just don't have time to even pick up a newspaper anymore.
But once again, guys, I think that's that was one of the reasons we started this whole thing. Why we go week to week, month to month, and year to year now. And you know, when we look at our educational system, Michael, I have notes. So we haven't really haven't delved in that much into the Common Core, but it really does. It comes out. So much of this mm-hmm. comes down to our education. I mean, when we're looking at and when we have these discussions with people that we feel as though are in the know, and then when you start talking about whether it's jury nullification, when you talk about the Presidential Debate Commission, when you talk about the Federal Reserve, and people are looking at you like, wow. I didn't realize that. Then you realize, boy, we're in a scary situation and why it's so important what we're doing and why we're doing this. And we have to find a way to continue to make this grow, guys. And X, I'll let you jump in on this thing a little bit.
Well, again, we're back to the same, never-ending story. But unfortunately, media is not designed to really inform. It's designed to entertain. And, well, I can't tell you when that exact moment happened or whatever. Maybe it was during the O.J. Simpson car chase that suddenly, news became a form of entertainment.
There you go.
But we're not in the business of keeping people informed. What the media and the establishment is designed to is to always reinforce that the system is in control and you should never think of some other solution than dealing within the system. And I guess that's why I always go back to my mantra that the most important vote you cast is how you spend your money.
Yep.
If you spend your money, you can reshape the world with your purchases if enough people get together. And, at the end of the day, I really think that that is the leveraging moment that every man and woman has to think about. Because, look, if you don't like, giving your money to foreign governments or whatever, buy an American car. And if you want organic vegetables, then buy organic vegetables. You don't have to create a law to stop people from buying Monsanto products. Just insist that you don't pay for them. Now, it might cost you more, but you will reshape your vision of what you want the world to be a hell of a lot quicker than trying to put some politician in who's really just an extortion racket.
You see, he had to throw me the softball. One last shot at this. I mean, when he said, you don't have to give your money to foreign governments. Can we take money from foreign governments for our campaigns, X? Or is that going to be another quick cheap shot?
Aren't some candidates already doing that?
No, it can't be. They would never do that. Who would take money from foreign governments?
Like, I don't know, like the Tata Corporation. I don't know anyone who would do that.
Michael, it doesn't stop. We're going to take a break when we come back. Charmaine Bradley from the Carbon County Independent Gazette.
Saturday mornings, 94.3 FM, The Talker. Settle down, it'll all be clear. Don't pay no mind to the demons, they fill you with fear. The trouble in my drag you down.
This is your home, 94.3 FM, The Talker, Sanity Check, Libertarian Lou, Tea Party Mike, and the home of the Independent Gazette, certainly, and we like to always say that the... when you need to come home and when you need to, if you have some information that you need to get out there, you could always give us a call, Michael. And certainly, we've certainly given that avenue to individuals to have a voice. Last week, we spoke with the Berks County Independent Gazette, Michael, and we really did thank our affiliates, because this is not an easy thing to do. We understand how difficult it is to get these papers not only off the ground, but the tremendous amount of resources it takes to do this. Not only, Michael, from, you know, the physical resources and the time and the energy, but the financial resources. And if we're truly going to have a free and independent press, these affiliates need to thrive, and we need to continue to grow, because it's a very, very difficult task that we have ahead of us. And certainly Carbon County has really led the way down there, Michael. That was the first one. So good morning, Charmaine.
Hey, Lou. How you doing?
We're doing great up here. And thank you once again for taking the time to come on this morning. And we're talking a little bit more about our affiliates. And I want to thank you and certainly Dave and for help leading the way. I know it hasn't been a easy road, so to speak, because you're helping set how these affiliates get set up. And we truly feel as though that the only way to continue to grow is to find ways to support the affiliates. And at the same token, you know, it's such a hard task, and the amount of work that you guys have done down there to build Carbon County into what you guys, you know, have been able to do. Certainly, you have a free charity concert, and I wanted to talk a little bit about, you know, before you even came on to the Independent Gazette and joined the Independent Gazette, both you and Dave have done a tremendous amount of work with charities. Certainly, you're a very giving family, and I think that's important for our listeners to understand that that's what this is all about, really. I mean, you've been doing this for a very long period of time, and we're going to be down. John and myself will be down there. You have booths at this a free charity concert that once again the Carbon County Independent Gazette is sponsoring. Tell us a little bit about that, and a little bit about you, and some of the hard tasks that or where you're going with the Independent Gazette.
Well, the charity is called. It's called A Picnic in the Park.
Okay.
And it's featuring music by Mike Stanley and friends, ADD, okay, Dave Shifford, and Gene Andrews from the Gene Andrews Band.
And that's today. And that's today at the Lee Heighton Amphitheater, and that's from 2 to 6. And certainly, we got a great day for that. I mean, we lucked out with that thing, right?
Well, yes, we're not going to get any rain, so that's important, you know. And we have the most important thing is that we're featuring 30 charities and nonprofits from Carbon County are going to be at this event.
And these are many charities that you have worked with in the past, and now you're bringing them together. And certainly what you've done with the Carbon County Independent Gazette is working with the charities to give them a voice and to try to give them as much exposure to the general public.
We have. We try to feature a couple charities in our papers every month. So, you know, Gail does our editor, one of our editors and reporters, Gail Mihalik. She does a great job with that.
The new women in media, as you advertise it. And I think that's fantastic, fantastic stuff. So, what else is, you know, you guys have certainly been on the forefront with what's happening with the school board down there. You certainly, and once again, spending a lot of your time and resources and getting this information out. I mean, some of your experiences with this, I know that once again, like us, you got into this without really knowing, you know, what's involved with a newspaper and how much time and effort. I mean, I think, have you found it's taken a lot more time and effort than you originally thought?
It has, yeah. But we have lots of friends who've, you know, gotten so much support from the community.
Right.
It's been wonderful, you know, and a lot of the people that write the stories are all from Carbon County. You know, that's the beauty of it.
And that is, and as we continue to grow, what we're doing is not only we talking about local content in these communities, but also what's happening in the state, and it's becoming a community newspaper. Certainly, as you tie this into all the charities that that you guys have worked with, both you and Dave. I mean, certainly as I've gotten to know you both as you know as a family, and the way you've interacted with your community for years, this is not something that just happened overnight. And I believe this is one of the reasons why you stepped into this craziness of printing the Carbon County Independent Gazette.
Thank you, Lou. That's really nice that you'd say that.
Well, it is. And I think it's not so, you know, it's important, I think, that sometimes that our listeners and people that have listened to this show realize the people that are part of this. I remember first meeting Dave in Wilkes-Barre with John D. Liberto and myself, and we sat down and talked, and we delved into a little bit, Michael, why we all got into this. And it was really for altruistic reasons and for the, I think, for the right reasons. And anybody that has been involved with the Gazette here knows that it's been a hard task. And one of the reasons, Charmaine, that we always do, we thank our subscribers and we thank our supporters.
Yeah,
and
we're so
people
grateful for, you know, our subscribers, our advertisers, you guys, you know.
And
been a learning process.
Has it ever been a learning process? So we're looking forward. Michael, you have any quick questions for Charmaine or thanks or, you know, certainly we're going to be down there in a few hours. And we're encouraging folks to come on down. I mean, the way you guys have set this up down there, if you had needed a table, and it's all free. I mean, it's this is something that you're doing for the community, and we want to make sure that our listeners, if you take a ride down to Jim Thorpe today, to go down to Carbon County, go down to Lee Height, and in the meantime, stop by and say hello to all the folks of the Independent Gazette and our family down there, Charmaine.
Yeah, I mean, come on down. It's a free concert, you know, and have a picnic in the park and bring your mom.
And bring your mom. There you go. Great. Michael, any quick thoughts on Carbon County and Charmaine?
Well, you know, I give everybody the credit who has decided to take the time and to really dedicate a lot of their time and money. And Lou, you certainly and John and certainly know what that means. To try and expose the truth, Charmaine. I know it's difficult, but it's certainly a worthwhile venture.
Charmaine, thanks for coming on, and we'll see you later on today, and we'll be enjoying the music, the sunshine, and just the camaraderie that you're going to be having down there in Carbon County today. So we'll see you in a couple hours.
All right, great. Thanks, Lou.
Talk to you soon.
Thanks, John. Yep, bye-bye.
There you go, Frank. I mean, once again, I have to say Carbon County, you know, was the first one, guys, that came on board. And we didn't have all our procedures in place. We certainly didn't, you know, and it's and we're still learning, Michael and X, as you guys know. And we'll be down there and seeing you in about 2 weeks on our way out to Las Vegas, LPEX, Michael, as we've mentioned here, we're going to be giving a seminar and a workshop on the Independent Gazette and hopefully blowing this across the country and expanding. Certainly, we've had a lot of interest, but we just haven't had the infrastructure in place, and I think we're getting there. I think we're getting there, guys. So, you know, thank you for everybody, X and Michael and Frank, for your efforts, and John. And I mean, the list goes on and on, and certainly for the affiliates that certainly have put their time, money, and resources. And Michael, and I'll keep bringing this up, you know, when we look at a free and independent press, if we want that, that's hard work. I mean, because we understand that it takes money to do these things. And you know, Frank, you know, the retribution that mm-hmm. we got in Wilkes-Barre right off the bat when all of a sudden our advertisers are getting paid visits and you wonder why. And if it wasn't for these affiliates, Michael, I'm not so sure that we've been able to get to the point that we've gotten to.
It's just nobody wants the truth out there. And the Independent Gazette has a long history of printing the truth at whatever cost.
Isn't that amazing?
That's it.
You know, I got to throw another thank you out to David Madeira. I was listening to his show this week once again. And he had a segment on smart meters, Michael. And so he had some experts on and all this stuff. But once again, we don't have all the information. But David threw it out there, and he says, this is a story that the Independent Gazette needs to delve into a little bit more, and maybe we'll get to the truth on the matter. And I thought that was – so thank you, David, on that. So, hey, guys, we're going to take another break when we come back. Judy Lorah-Fisher is on the – this is a woman that's going to be going to – John Yudichak's office with some of our group, and she was also the one that led the way with the Kids for Cash. So, interesting conversation coming up on 94.3 FM The Talker.
If you've been let down by the political class, you say what you want to say.
It's easier said than done sometimes, Frank.
Absolutely.
You
want
to be brave. Michael, as you know, and X, you know, standing up and getting out there and knowing that the retribution and the and what's happening and what could happen with retribution from the courts, you do need to be brave. And one of the things or one of the individuals that have stood up is Judy Fisher. Good morning, Judy.
Hi, Lou. How are you?
We're doing good, Judy, and thanks for joining us. Let's start out first. Let's give a little our listeners a little bit of history about who you are and why you got involved with the custody for cash issues and why you and some of the group that meets at the Elm Park Church each month here in Scranton plan on going to see John Yudichak starting tomorrow, I believe. On Monday. And trying to ask for the resources of what is needed to start calling for a court reform and having open forums and public hearings here in Luzerne and Lackawanna County. And that's the first salvo. But for those that are maybe not familiar with Kids for Cash, and certainly we've heard a lot about it in the news, but, you know, after spending time at your house and watching the movie and just having the emotion that you showed about your niece and the individuals that are part of that, I think that was important. But going back to Kids for Cash, and one of the reasons that you're going to be doing what you're doing, and one of the reasons I asked you on today is that if folks want to join you, go into John Yudichak's office this week, and that's only the first round of stuff. But you were the one that actually went to John Yudichak, I believe, back in 2007, with about 130 something names from. High schoolers from Nanticoke. Did I get that correct?
Yes. Yes. I went to John because my hometown is Nanticoke, Pennsylvania. At that time in 2007, he was the state representative.
Correct.
Along with my niece and about 153 kids, I had names and numbers and what their offenses were, which were non-criminal, and there was many children being incarcerated without any criminal charges. And I started to see numerous of children being placed in detention centers. I could not get my niece out at that time. I became aware of the fact that they were incarcerating children for no criminal offenses. I was heartbroken, shook me to my core each week that I went to visit her up at the juvenile centers and realized that this was something really big that was happening. And so I reached out to John Yudichak, the state representative, and said, please, can you help us? There's thousands of children, and there's so many stories, story after story after story, and I'm hearing more and more every weekend. And he then looked at my list of papers that I had on all the children and their families, and he said, let me look into this. He said, this seems very alarming that there's 153 kids from our hometown that are incarcerated. And he called me in about a week later, and he said that there was more than 153 kids, that he was going to make some phone calls to the right people and get some awareness on what was going on. And that's about what he was able to do, is make the calls to the bigger people. And that took, with his calls, along with other people calling, and then I encouraged the families to start calling the newspaper and the Times Leader and the, you know, anywhere that anybody would start to be aware of the children being incarcerated. And as I started getting families to start calling, not only their mothers and fathers, but their grandmothers and grandfathers, their cousins, their aunts, that the phones were nonstop ringing. And that's how we were able to get them to realize that there was hundreds and hundreds of children that this was happening to. And basically, the power in numbers is what really got the attention of the bigger people to start coming and helping getting these children out of the centers and pressing charges on the judges who were then, at that time, taking the children and putting them in the centers and making a profit on them.
Now, you got involved. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
What sounds familiar for me here is, and this shakes me to my core, the families are being torn apart again, just like when it was in the Kids for Cash. Kids' rights are being violated. No one, again, is listening to the children. And this is exactly the same thing that happened when we were going through all this with the Kids for Cash. No one wanted to listen to the children. You know, the system is broken. The system is not what it should be. It should be for people's rights to be, you know, heard, and people's rights not to be violated. You know, this is exactly what has been happening. I sat and watched hundreds and hundreds of families being torn apart from each other. Children screaming for their mothers. Mothers screaming for their
children.
Child. fathers, you know, and it just, it's the same thing that's happening here that we're fighting up against again.
And let me, just to be clear, what we have dubbed custody for cash, you have no skin in the game with custody for cash. It's not like this is an issue that you could say, boy, I've been violated by the family courts. It's not. It's you became aware of this through the efforts of Bruce Levine, some of the efforts of the Independent Gazette, some of the efforts of those individuals that go to these meetings in Scranton. And you're looking at this, if I have this correctly, and saying, wait a minute. You know, this is very much the same stuff, and we've been talking about it now, just like you might have done it for years prior to maybe getting an ear and somebody to finally listen. But I mean, we've been on this for well over a year, and I'm saying, and we've been saying the same thing that you're saying. You know, the sheer volume of individuals that are coming forward and complaining about what's happened in these court systems, and then. And they operate in secrecy, really, correct?
Correct.
So what you're planning on doing is that we're starting to repeat the process. And one of the reasons that, once again, I had asked you to come on was that, you know, to let folks know that you're going to start the whole process over again. You're going to start with going to John Yudichak, and we're going to start asking not just for John. He was just the first one because you've had good results with him before. But we're going to start going to these state representatives, our local state representatives, and asking what do they need from us for them to provide public hearings and public forums on court corruption in Luzerne and Lackawanna counties. Do I have that right?
That's correct. I will be doing that Monday at 10 o'clock in the morning. John's office is right next to the state representative now. They're in the same actual building. I plan on going to both of them and asking them, what do you need from us? What do you need? Do you need 200 stories? Do you need 400 stories? Do you need 5? How many do you want to look into to get this awareness to the bigger people, just like we did when I walked in there with 153 kids?
There you go.
That's where we're going on Monday.
And we want public hearings on this. We want this to be exposed and once and for all get it out in the open, because we know, and Judy, certainly some of the things that I know that you knew with Kids for Cash is that the sheer intimidation that even lawyers and court officials have because if they do come and speak out, doctors, we've talked about that. If they do, they're going to lose their practice. They're going to lose their license. Careers. They're going to lose their licenses. And certainly those are one of the things that we need to expose. Mm-hmm. We want that exposed. These individuals, and we've heard this all the time, guys, is that they work for us as the taxpaying public. So
us as the people.
As we the people, that is correct. Judy, our time is so short, but I did want to make sure that we had you on a little bit and talk a little bit more about this. Certainly, we're going to have you on again because even with your niece, I got to tell you, if I started talking about it today, I'll probably just get choked up. A 13-year-old young girl, if I have it correctly, hit another girl in the head with the volleyball and sitting in court there, and all of a sudden her legs are shackled, her hands are shackled, and screaming for mommy, screaming for help, and they take her off, and it was 6 years in jail or something close to that, correct?
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, boy.
No matter what I did. I mean, it was just so bad and so corrupt that I just, there was everything that I could do to try to get her out, and I could not get her out. And that's when I realized I was up against something bigger than I could ever imagine.
It's unbelievable.
It's totally unbelievable.
When I hear a story like that, it infuriates me because as a a teenager, I should have been executed.
Exactly.
You know, I was the world's worst athlete. and just look at me, you could probably tell that I'm the world's worst athlete. But anyway, I was forced to play basketball, a sport I was never good at. And the first time I grabbed the ball and threw it, missed the net completely, came down and clocked Mrs. Jabinski, our gym teacher, right in the head. Almost knocked her unconscious. And for that, I probably should have been pulled out of Tunkhannock High School, hung right in town square.
Yeah, and Judy, once again, we encourage folks to, if they haven't seen the movie or learn a little bit more, because I believe they there were five individuals, right, in the Kids for Cash that they focused on.
Yes.
And certainly your niece and your niece was one of them, and that was just one of the stories. Individual that stole bought
all minimum offenses. I mean,
and spent years. And right, then when we talk about Sandy Fonzo and a kid committing suicide, and it goes on and on. And we could spend the whole show just on this alone, Judy. But listen, thank you for your efforts. Thank you to Bruce Levine. Thank you for the individuals that are stepping forward. And thank you for pushing this forward. Certainly, if anybody needs to wants to go with you, Judy, they could either go to Voices or go to the Independent Gazette Facebook pages, and we'll get them your information. And onwards, Judy. Thank you for the work that you're doing, and thanks for stepping into this. Once again, folks, I want to remind you that you have no skin in this game, except for the fact that you see the same things happening with Custody for Cash that you saw for Kids for Cash.
And I want no other children to be hurt and left behind, and this happening to them. That's what I want. I want to protect the children again.
God bless you, Judy.
God bless you, Judy. We're going to take a break. When we come back, Larry Hoho's going to be online with us and talking a little bit more about court corruptions. You're listening to Sanity Check on 94.3 FM, The Talker. So wake me up. Wake me up. That's why we got Larry Hoho joining us. He's going to try to wake us up here a little bit. The author of the Luzerne County Railroad. Larry, good morning. The reason we asked you on, and I know our time is so short, but I think it was important. Certainly, you're going to be up here in federal court in Wilkes-Barre, trial set for Monday, the Robert Leone police brutality case. Good morning, Larry.
Good morning. Thank you for having me on.
Oh, absolutely. Hey, listen, the main thing is we want to shed a little bit of light on what's going on. Just briefly, give our listeners a little bit of background on yourself.
Certainly. I'm a former police officer from the borough of Luzerne. I ended up leaving my department and building a large medical equipment manufacturing company that I sold. Became involved in litigation with the company that bought my company and truly discovered the corruption in the Luzerne County Courthouse, where judges can be bought and sold, kind of like stolen goods at a flea market, if you will. Ended up writing a book about it called The Luzerne County Railroad. And because of that book, I received a phone call one day from what sounded to be an elderly woman, very well-spoken, and she explained a situation with that involved her son and the Pennsylvania State Police. After she gave me the basic information, I told her I didn't think there was anything I could do to help her. It was basically her son's word against seven police officers, five of which were Pennsylvania State Troopers. And she sounded very disappointed, but she said, I have... I have a copy of their dash cam video that shows everything I just told you. And I said, really? I said, well, first of all, how the heck did you get that? And she said she got it from the public defender that was representing him in court. She said, can I send you a copy of it? So she did. And honestly, I threw it on my desk, and I was busy with other things, and I didn't look at it for a week.
Yeah.
She called me back and asked me if I had a chance to look at it, and I apologized, and I looked at it that night. Well, I simply couldn't believe what I was looking at. And I'm not out there, you know, trying to take down windmills or anything like that. Originally I was like, you know, I want to get so far away from the corruption in Pennsylvania that I moved to Florida. That's how strongly I felt about it. But the more I dug into this case, the more I saw it wasn't just a case about brutality. It was a case about brutality, cover up by the Pennsylvania State Police, malicious, vicious prosecution by a county district attorney, and on and on and on. The layers of corruption in this case are so extensive, it almost comes across as worse than the Kids for Cash scandal. The difference is, I don't believe any actual cash is exchanging hands.
Yep.
But what I'm seeing, and I started this over 2 years ago, long before the police brutality issue rose to the surface like it is right now. So I ended up doing a video, putting it on YouTube. But before I put it on YouTube, I used it to get him an attorney, a law firm. He has a large law firm from Pittsburgh that reviewed the entire case and said that they couldn't believe it either. They have taken the case on. They won't get a penny out of this thing unless they win. Not a penny. And they have now spent probably hundreds of thousands of dollars on the case.
Right.
So they're very serious about what they're doing. It's going to trial. Finally, it's been delayed by the state for over a year. It was supposed to go to trial last June, so almost a year. It's going to trial starting this Monday at the courthouse, the federal courthouse in Wilkes-Barre. 9:30 in the morning will be jury selection. We're assuming that jury selection will take one day, and then trial probably will start on Tuesday. But none of that's written in stone other than we're starting at 9:30. It'll be courtroom number 3. I have people from all over the country that are actually coming in for the hearing, for the trial. That's where we're at with it as far as moving forward. Any questions?
I got to tell you, after I looked at the video also, and the individual's name is Robert Leone. I think I'm saying that the right way, but the beating this individual took, and the circumstances that happened around is just mind-boggling. And once again, I want to point out that. You're a former police officer. You didn't. You're not looking at this, with some kind of axe to grind. And just like us, Larry, we the sheer volume of information that we're getting, sometimes it does sit on our desk for months on time, only because we just can't get to it. And we wish we had the ability to get to these stories that constantly keep coming to us. But, you know, where can folks even look at this if they want to go look at that video, where would they go?
They would go to YouTube and search Worse Than Rodney King.
Worse Than Rodney King. And I got to tell you, Frank, I got to tell you, I don't know if you've seen this video, but this is mind-blowing. It really is. And Larry, once again, I want to thank, just like I thank Charmaine Bradley, who was on here earlier, and Judy Lorah-Fisher. I want to thank you also. I mean, we've our paths have crossed a little bit, certainly about with the court corruptions. But the time and effort and resources that you have spent to expose what's going on in these courtrooms, I think that's vital, and without individuals like yourself and like Charmaine Bradley and like Judy Fisher, I just don't know how we would get light shown on what's happening in our communities.
Well, one of the key points here with this case is the exposure of rogue officers. They make the job of the good police officers expeditiously worse. I mean, it's amazing that they are not only allowed to get away with this, but the upper management of say, the Pennsylvania State Police actually participates in these cover-ups. And it makes one of the things that happened when I went public with this is I started getting phone calls from Pennsylvania State Troopers.
Right.
And it was amazing. I was like, At first, I thought I was going to get a lot of negative threats and things like that, and I was supported. I've been supported, even with upper echelon state troopers based out of Harrisburg have called me. So I am very, very comfortable in my role in as far as exposing this. The good state troopers, and there are plenty of them, are endorsing what I'm doing here. And if I was successful, which I was not, if I was successful in getting a federal probe into this matter, I was assured that a line of Pennsylvania state troopers would extend out the door and around the block that would want to talk to federal investigators about corruption. And we may be able to revisit that at a later date.
That's fantastic. Larry, like I said, our time is short, but I thought it was important for our listeners to know that this trial starts, and we will see you this week in Wilkes-Barre, and we'll continue this conversation. So thanks so much for coming on today, and we'll see you on Monday. Hey, guys, once again, our time flies here, and we tried to get a lot in today, and I think it's really important, not only what's happening in Carbon County, and we encourage folks to come down and take a chill pill and listen to some great music down there, and certainly we could talk a little bit more. If you do come down, we could delve into these subjects a little bit more. What's happening with Judy Lorah-Fisher going to John Yudichak's office and starting the process of asking for help there. Worse than Rodney King. X, when you see this video, you're not going to believe it. Michael, you too. We will be there. And we're down. We're down. X, just a few seconds for you. Any last thoughts?
Yeah, I mean, if we somehow think we're going to be able to fix places like Syria and other places around the world, and Luzerne County is in this state, we need to have our heads examined, start at home before we start thinking abroad.
always great observations from X, man. It's unbelievable. So thanks, Michael. We're down to the last 40 seconds. You know how this show goes here, my friend. You got the last word as always, man.
Absolutely. God bless all, and particularly those who are trying to fight for the truth, Will.
Absolutely. God bless everybody. We'll be back next week on 94.3 FM, The Talk, a Sanity Check. Have a great weekend.